set me free. You broke the bonds of prison for me. Well, I'm glory bound, my Jesus, to see. Oh, glory to God, He set me free. Well, He set me free. He set me free. He broke the bonds of prison for me. Well,
prayer tonight. Father, we love you. We thank you for your goodness, your grace, your mercy. God, all that you bestowed upon us, just allowing us to be here under the tent tonight to worship you in spirit and in truth. And Father, I pray, God, for all the songs of Zion that will be sung tonight. I pray for the preaching hour. I pray for the preacher, God, tonight. God, I pray, God, that you'd meet with us here tonight under the tent, God, that you'd touch every home and every family, God, that's represented here tonight. Father, I pray, God, that you'd examine every heart and every life, God, that's here. And Father, ones may have come by our way, God, tonight. They may have had a smile upon their face, God. They may have had their makeup on right. God, everything, it looks on the outside, but chaos has broke out in their life on the inside. And I pray, God, that you'd bring peace that passes all understanding in their life, God, tonight. And Father, I pray, God, that ones that may be here tonight, that may have come, and they may have come, and they may have hidden their sin, God, they'd be lost and undone. Father, I pray that the sweet Holy Ghost of God would convict them and bring them around an old-fashioned altar of repentance before it's everlasting too late. Father, I pray, God, you bless us tonight. God, I pray you touch us one more time, God, this side of heaven. And we love you and thank you for all that you do. In Christ's name we pray. And the people of God said,
amen.
You may be seated in the presence of the Lord if you can tonight. He is worthy of our praise here tonight. Aren't you glad?
Our God. glory, hallelujah, to our God.
Praise the Lord. We'll get it all worked out here in just a minute. I'm glad, hallelujah, regardless of electronics or regardless of all the technicalities, I'm thankful that tonight God still has mercy. God still has grace. His mercy is everlasting. His grace is sufficient. I'm here to tell you, I say bless his holy name for the mercy of an almighty God. I didn't get what I deserved. I should have been in hell with my back broke. But God showed me mercy. But God gave me mercy. And I say hallelujah. I bless his name for the mercy of God.
Let me free. And that's what you mean. words you did for me.
That's what your mercy.
And that's what your mercy did for me. That's what your mercy did for me.
Let's all stand up tonight as we worship the Lord together. I'm glad for His presence tonight.
Amen.
Your glory, God, is one. to be overcome by your presence, Lord. Let us become more aware of your presence. Let us experience the glory of your goodness. Let us become more aware of your presence. Let us experience the glory of your goodness. Let us become more aware of your presence. Let us experience the glory of your goodness. Let us become more aware of your presence. Let us experience the glory of your goodness.
I want more of you, God.
soul that I can't contain, that I can't control. I want more of you, God. I want more of you, God. No place I'd rather be. No place I'd rather be. No place I'd rather be than here in your love.
Good, amen. We're going to have Brother Ron Duncan. He's got some of his folks that are going to help him tonight. And he's a good friend of mine. Several years ago, I called him, and I knew who he was a little bit and didn't really know him. And we talked on the phone for 30 minutes, an hour, or whatever. And we've become friends over the years, and I'm thankful for his ministry. I'm thankful for his friendship. And he always brings an on-time word when he comes this way. And it's good to see Miss Roxanne out tonight. She's feeling pretty tough last night, and she's still got a little ways to go, but I believe that we serve a healing God. We serve a God that's able. Amen. Amen. And so tonight, Brother Ron, I'll just turn it over to you. And we're looking forward to it. I love you.
Praise the Lord, everybody. Everybody needs everybody. Praise the Lord, everybody. Amen. How about getting anything on my ears?
All power in heaven.
it may resonate with you personally tonight. You see, so many times I've lowered my bucket into that old dark well of sin, and it always gets a dry and dusty bottom. Oh, but that's when God's Spirit reminds me again. He said, I am the water. I am the light. There's no need to search for.
Yeah!
1920.
Yep.
He woke me up this morning. Somebody say that's a cliche. Some people didn't get up this morning.
Uh-huh.
So I'll take it personal that God woke me up this morning. And it's another day that I can magnify him and praise him. Amen. Yeah. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. I got one more request. I just try to get them in. A song a friend of mine wrote called The Battle, and I hope it's a blessing to you tonight. No matter what battle you're going through, what battle you're facing, he's already fought your battle. Amen. Anybody believe that this afternoon, this evening? This battle is gonna be a hard one.
Oh God.
Oh, yeah.
The enemy surrounded my soul. Every side. So I girded up my loins.
Yeah. Yeah.
And I made preparations for this fight. And just before it happened, I heard Jesus say, this one's mine. All curse sound from heaven, sounded like rushing mighty waves. That old enemy surrendered. I heard angels shouting, just remember that the Savior's every day. To walk straight the narrow way. Everyone, you know sometimes the road gets hard. But remember, child of God, you're not the only one. Just remember that our Savior never fought a battle that he hasn't won. I love this. Oh, and then I heard a sound from heaven. Tell me, Lord, we're rushing by your
way.
That only enemy surrendered. Chores. Amen. So, happy wife's a happy life. Amen.
Uh-huh.
But she gives her greetings. Amber says hello. And my son's over here. And Zach, I thank God for all of our team with us tonight. Would you give the Lord some praise right here? They'll help keep it from being boring tonight. Amen. If I start lagging and slowing down, they'll kick it in here, and we'll have some jet fuel going here in a minute. So they'll help us. Amen.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you, Pastor Chris Doster and Pastor Kenny. I don't know where he's at. Is he here? The great Kenny Mars with us tonight. And I get to preach in front of this great man of God. Amen.
Uh-huh.
Pastor, we love you. Thank you for what you do.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Let's give God praise for our pastor and minister. You're a minister of the gospel. Stand up tonight. I'm not talking about lay people. I'm talking about pastors, any other pastors here tonight. Pastor David Tucker, my friend back there, stand up from Destiny Church International, right back there. Got his daughter Sadie with us. He's definitely got a full schedule, and I thank him for being with us tonight as well. And I thank all of you for being here.
Amen.
Amen. You're not common folk.
Mm-hmm.
You're God's children.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
You're royal priesthood tonight.
Yep.
Amen. You're the apple of God's eye tonight.
Mm-hmm.
Amen.
Right.
So if you got a Bible or an app, either one, open that thing up to Psalms chapter 73. Psalms chapter 7. My glasses keep fogging up here. I'm going to do the best I can. I wish I installed wiper blades on them.
There's a reason for that.
Yeah.
Do you know the altar or thank you by Ray Ball?
The altar. Yeah, I got that song. You just think my voice would fit that song good or something? I got that on the old list. $29.95 says. This is karaoke request night with the tent. Bless your heart. Where are you from? What church are you from?
Right now I don't have one.
Oh, praise God. Well, I would invite you to Marinara. Marinara, is it Marinara?
Yeah, Marinara. Marinara.
Marinara.
That works.
They put me up to that, Pastor. I found it was a great place to throw Marinara in here. My son are great friends with Gage and Caleb over here, and I thank God they've got a good relationship. And they'll stay over at the church sometimes, and they'll be working on music, and God knows what they're doing. But they're young, good young men. And my son, he'll come in on Sunday mornings wearing a Marinara shirt. Marinara Baptist.
Yeah.
And so, Gage, you got a place church, right? We got to get Gage a place church, okay? Y'all take yours off right now and give that boy. It's good to have the place church, some of our place church. Wave at us if you're from the place church. Amen. Good to have you with us tonight. Please hand out your cards. Amen. Good to have y'all. It's a good church right here. It's a good pastor. I don't say that for everybody.
I've enjoyed it all week long.
I'm so glad you have, and we're glad you came.
I'm Pentecostal, but I was a Baptist
apostle
first.
Well, honey, we all got Acts chapter 2 in us. Amen.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And people say the Baptists don't have the Holy Ghost. I beg to differ. The Bible says you can't be saved unless the Holy Ghost draws you. So the Holy Ghost is working in the Baptist church. Hey.
Yeah.
Come on. We all got it. Amen. If you're saved, you got some Holy Ghost working. I'm going to try to remember the words. Now listen, it's been the 90s since I sang this song, so I'm going to try my best.
Before you sing, I want to say something.
Say it again.
Before you say anything.
No, I'm going to thank the Lord for letting me be. Oh, he's testifying. I don't know what she's doing. Go ahead, brother.
Thank the Lord for saving my soul when I was a teenager.
Amen. Well, praise God. Let's give God praise for saving this young man's soul.
Just as I am. There's a light in the darkness.
He's waiting here for you. Come quickly now before they close the door. That's what this altar is for. Our Father is praying with His Son, and a mother kneels beside them, thanking God they've come, and an old man is standing there in tears. He's given up a part of him that he's held back for years. Hearts are being broken and lives are being changed. And those who call upon him right now will never be the same. Come quickly now before he closes the door. That's what this altar is for. He's waiting here for you. The time has come to give them to the Lord. You can give your burdens to the Lord. Oh, that's what this altar is for. That's what this altar is for. Coming down from the Father above, sweep over my spirit forever, I pray, in fathomless billows, less billows of love. Give God praise in this time. Sit down and just let the Holy Ghost do it. He's moving.
I want to give a word of testimony. That song that you just sang, preacher, back in 1998, there was a youth choir from Kannapolis, the Bible Missionary Baptist Church that came, brought their youth choir, the pastor came, and we were supposed to have a three-night jubilee. It turned into a two-week revival. And on that night, down in the altar, I surrendered. I gave my heart and life to the work of the ministry. I didn't know what God would do. I didn't really know what God could do. But I said, God, you can have it.
Amen.
And I got up and I knew that God had called me into ministry. Maybe you're here tonight and you're saved, but you've never really sold out to God. You've never really given everything in your heart and everything in your life, in your future, to God. I don't know what he's going to preach on. He'll do whatever the Lord is, where the Lord's leading. I know that. But maybe tonight, God is calling you. Maybe God's telling you, I want more of you. We sang about, Lord, I want more of you, God. But maybe God's saying, I want more of you. Somebody said, Brother Ron was talking about Acts chapter number 2. The day I got saved, I got all of the Holy Ghost that I'd ever get. But from that day to this day, God's been getting more of me. He's been grabbing hold of more of me. I got the fullness of the Holy Ghost when I got saved, but he's been working on this flesh. He's been dealing with this flesh all this time. He's been trying to get Egypt out of us. And I'm here to tell you, God wants all of you tonight. I want to do this. I didn't come to do this. I had no intentions. Just keep playing something real soft there. How many of us, just stand up all over the building if you can, or the tent. How many of us would come and say, God, I don't have to know the end. I don't have to know the answer. But Lord, I'm going to come and lay my life at your feet. You can have all of me. While they're playing, come on. How many of us just slip around these altars and say, God, I'm laying my life down. I'm giving everything that I have, everything that I am. I will lay it at your feet. Lord, if it means my career doesn't end up where I thought it was going to end up, then God, I'm okay with that. Lord, if my life don't look like it's, I thought it would, I'm okay with that. I want to give everything I am and everything I will be to you tonight. I lay it at your feet. I give you my all. Thank you.
thank you for everybody that's being obedient already tonight in this service. Amen. 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 I know I've got a word that I want to give tonight. So I'm going to give it. I know the Lord wouldn't give me a word if he didn't want me to preach it.
Amen.
Amen. Grab your Bible, Psalms chapter 73. Psalms chapter 73. And I'm just going to go very quickly and just get straight to where I feel like the Lord's wanting us to go tonight. Psalms chapter 73, and there was a psalmist here that was having some issues. He was caught in some circumstances in his life. He was filled with doubt in his mind. He was confused about everybody around him in the world that was being prosperous. The unrighteousness and the unrighteous were being blessed, and it seemed like the world was not suffering. And the psalmist had a problem with God. He had a problem with the circumstances. His whole being had been vexed by the circumstances, and he wondered how a good God could allow evil to go on unchecked and the good people being unrewarded.
Mm-hmm.
He was in his life, and I'm getting ready to give you the scripture tonight. He was in a place in his life where he kept his eyes on the world. He kept his eyes on everything but God.
Yeah.
He was looking at the news. He was looking at everybody else but God. Come on, does that sound familiar here tonight? And the psalmist was writing. He was at a place where he felt like he could not get out of it. He wasn't praising God. He wasn't singing hymns. Mm-hmm. He was in a place in his life where he was saying, "Oh, woe as me."
Mm-hmm.
And I don't know about you, but I've been there numerous times in my own life. You can believe that or not, but I have been in a place, woe is me.
Yeah.
I'm pretty good at covering it up.
Yeah.
Amen.
Right.
Preachers normally cover up when they're going through something in pain.
Mm-hmm.
Because if you show weakness, church folk tend to think you're weak.
You're right.
But God wants us to show our weakness so that he can be made strong.
Mm-hmm.
And how can we preach about overcoming if people don't ever see preachers overcoming something?
Come on.
I'm preaching better than I'm putting on already. But this psalmist was in a place, but the Bible said, and I'm reading, I don't have much light up here, but I'm reading Psalms chapter 73. He said in verse 17, he was all these things. He was vexed. But until I went into the sanctuary of God. I want you to catch that thing right there.
Yep.
Until I went into the sanctuary of God.
Uh-huh.
Until I went to a place that was set aside for worship.
Yep.
Uh-huh. I believe that the church is really in during this pandemic that we've come to a place where we began to realize that the sanctuary is important.
Uh-huh.
Now, I'm not a novice, to believe that I think that's the church, that building. Mm-hmm. I don't believe that. I believe that's brick and mortar. But I do believe that we're the temple of the living God.
Right.
But I do believe that when God's people get together, and the Bible tells us and shows us that when we get in one mind and one accord,
uh-huh,
great things began to happen.
Yep.
And I've noticed all through the scriptures in the New Testament, before they ever had their first building or sanctuary, that they would go from house to house breaking bread and fellowshipping and testifying and koinonia, godly fellowship together, sharing one another of the daily battles that they were going through and the trials, and they almost got beheaded. They almost got caught enough to get stoned, and they began to share their testimonies and draw strength from one another. I don't know about you, but I miss the sanctuary. I miss I miss the choir, and I miss the praise team, and I miss the grandmas in the church, and I miss the papas in the church, and I miss being greeted and saying hello, because sometimes you don't get it out there in the world, but when you can get to the sanctuary, it's a place that we set aside for God to come meet with us together as a corporate body, and we're seeing so much. We're seeing death, and we're seeing sickness, and we're seeing people bound up, and we're seeing people dying, but come on, somebody, and we're seeing people lying, and we're seeing people telling all these other things around us, but I need to get back to the sanctuary, because I am man, because if I can get to the sanctuary, I can get a hold of God. I'm not God, but I can, there's one cord can be easily broken, two can be hardly broken, but if you get three cords together, honey, you can't do nothing with us. My God, when we can get three cords back into the sanctuary, I tell you tonight, I come right here under this tent to tell you we're going back to the sanctuary. I said we're going back to the sanctuary. This psalmist had enough. He had had enough. He couldn't find it outside of the sanctuary. He couldn't find peace outside of the sanctuary. He couldn't find what he was looking for outside of the sanctuary. He thought that the wicked were exempt from troubles in their life because of what this psalmist was seeing. He looked special. He took special notice at the pride of the wicked. It's in this chapter how the wicked people had pride. How they were so built up with pride, and they were so bound up with pride, and they walked around with their noses up in the air as if they were better than everybody else. And here was a psalmist that loved God, and it seemed like the wicked and the world was doing better than the people that were serving God. But he was deceived. He was deceived because many times if you get out of the reach of a shepherd. Sometimes you got a shepherd. Sometimes they don't preach down to you, but sometimes they'll lift you up and they'll give you an encouraging word. And one thing may preach to you one way, and one thing may preach to you another way. What that means is you may preach to you in a revelation knowledge. What that means is it may be revealed to you one way, and Georgette, it might be revealed to you in another way. There's a thing tonight I've come by to tell you that God gave us preachers that's going to lead us and guide to us and preach the gospel to us and encourage us one with another and encourage our spirits and charge our spirits. I'm ready to get back to the sanctuary. I'm ready to get back to where the altars are full and people are praying and people are worshiping God together. I said I'm ready to get back to the sanctuary. He was distressed because of the popularity of the wicked. Have you noticed in this generation how popular the wicked is? How the ratings are going up. He became dismayed over the wicked person's contempt for God. Look at it in that chapter, in chapter 73. He was upset because these people did not reverence God. He was watching those people. He was puzzled over the material prosperity of the wicked. He was disturbed and distracted about the iniquities in this life. He was at a place in his life where he seemed like he could never climb a mountain. He could never move a mountain. He could never get around the mountain. He was just in a place where he had built himself in a gridlock. Oh, I feel the Holy Ghost coming right here. He saw that the rich were not in a place where they knew how to build something. It seemed like they were building something. But when he went to the sanctuary, the Bible shows us he got a revelation. The Bible tells us he got a dream kind of thing going on. What that meant was God revealed to him that the world may have stuff, but their stuff is connected to quicksand. And there's no, oh, come on somebody, because the world has built themselves upon the devil, but the church and God's people have built ourselves upon a chief cornerstone, and his name is Jesus. He was the stone that the builders had rejected. I'm preaching right now. I'm telling you, the church of the living God doesn't have to look at the world and be second-class citizens.
Yeah, you're right.
We're God's people.
Uh-huh.
We're God's people. We got to snap out of it.
God help us.
We're coming back to the sanctuary. And I don't need any pills.
Uh-huh. Yep.
To come back to the sanctuary.
Uh-huh.
I don't need a doctor to tell me I can go back to the sanctuary.
Yep.
I don't need the government to tell me I got to go back to the sanctuary.
Uh-huh.
I need a prescription from the Holy Ghost. Amen. I need to go down there to CVS. Amen. And tell them I got a prescription. And they say, what's your prescription? Is it Prozac? I said, no. It ain't Prozac. They say, you come here to get a prescription? I said, yeah, I come down here to the CVS to get a prescription. They said, what kind of prescription you going to get?
Yeah.
I said, I didn't come down here to get no Zoloft.
No.
I came down here to get a prescription. And I don't know if you got it or not, but it's called sanctuary.
Yeah.
And if I could ever get into the sanctuary, it's a place of safety. It's a place, amen, hallelujah, where there's security, where I don't have to worry about anybody judging me. You better hear me right now. The sanctuary ain't a place for you to look at who's got Gucci and who don't. The sanctuary ain't a place of who's got the nicest shoes and the nicest dress and the prettiest hat. The sanctuary ain't about what car you drove up in here in. The sanctuary ain't about you. It's about you coming together and magnifying the Lord. And the Bible said when you praise Him, He'll inhabit the praise of His people.
Yeah.
And He'll come down to where we are. And He'll move down every aisle. And He'll move down every pew. And He'll pour up. Hallelujah. He'll move. He'll move when you praise Him.
Yep.
I said He'll move when you praise Him.
Uh-huh.
I said He'll move when you praise Him. 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 I had church by myself and I got to. I said He'll move when you praise Him. I said He'll move. He'll move.
Yep.
When you praise Him.
Mm-hmm.
Some of you sitting there talking about move me. I ain't trying to move you. I'm moving me. I'm moving me. I can't worry about what the world's doing.
That's good.
I said hallelujah.
Mm-hmm.
I said hallelujah. There's people right now that's ready to praise God, but they're afraid of people looking at them.
Yep.
They pray they're going to be out of order. I've come down to tell you, praise is always in order. I'm about to close. I just won't let the governor know. We're going back in the sanctuary. I want the Senate to know. We're going back in the sanctuary.
Yep.
I want my local government to know. I'm going back in the sanctuary. But most of all, I said most of all, I want God to know that when I walked into the sanctuary, I was ready. I was glad. I said I was glad. Some of us need to be on our tenth day. Usually. preacher, what you talking about? One of my young sons in the Lord, he posted a scripture the other day. And it was Revelation chapter 2, I think verse 10. And it talked about, it was Revelation chapter 2, verse 10. And it talked about the people of God being in prison and in persecution. And I don't know about you, but we've been in persecution. The church is being persecuted right now. I said the church of the living God is being persecuted right now.
Right.
Now you say, preacher, there ain't nobody doing nothing to God. Well, you need to ask what God said to Saul. On the road to Damascus. I feel the old preacher coming up in me. Hey! I got to hang up this city preacher for about 5 minutes and get on back down out of Essie Street down there at Calvary Free Will Baptist where I cut my teeth on the altar preacher. I mean, we think that we're hurting each other. But the Lord showed up to Saul. Saul was a murderer. Saul killed Christians.
Yep.
He beheaded them. He stoned them.
Yep.
Oh, and he was at a place. But he was on his way to find some more to kill. But all of a sudden, there was a light shined. And I know it was the Lord.
Yeah.
He said, Saul, why do you persecute me? You know what he said? He said, when you kill somebody that's a believer, you're killing me. When you persecute a believer, you're killing me. When you talk about and backbite a believer, you're talking about me. So what I'm telling you is this. Don't worry about what people say about you. Vengeance is mine, said the Lord. I feel somebody's about to get rescued under the truth. I'll tell you, you don't have to worry about the tyrant on Facebook. You don't have to worry about going to the preacher.
Yep.
God's been watching. I said, God's been watching. I said, God's been watching.
Yep.
Now he's taking notes.
Uh-huh.
He's taking notes. Do you hear me? I said God's taking notes. And you can't mess with God's people that God don't know it. He said, Saul, why do you persecute me? And then right then and there, Saul had an encounter with God. I didn't come up in here tonight to tell you I got all the answers.
Uh-huh.
But I did come to tell you I got an answer. And you don't need a bunch of answers. The answer.
Yep.
When you come into the contact with I am, that I am. When you come in contact with the Rose of Sharon.
Uh-huh.
He said, Revelations, I'm about to close Revelation. He said, 10. He said right there, he said, while they were persecuted in prison, this was the very job. People in that day, they were Olympics. And they would get prizes and awards. And they would get crowns on their head.
Yeah.
They would serve pagan gods. Revelation chapter 2 and verse 10. Read that chapter when you get time. And you'll find out that it looks closely to what this world is looking like today. That everybody wants a crown, but nobody wants to die. Everybody wants a crown, but nobody wants to take up a cross and follow after him. Everybody wants a crown, but nobody wants to go to jail for Jesus. I want to know, is there anybody ready to take a charge for the name of Jesus.
Oh.
Is there anybody wrong? Start singing up your melody for Jesus. I come glory. Revelation chapter 2 and verse 10. He said this was a time of tribulation, a time of trials. It was a time of adversity. It was time where the weight was on the people of God. If there's ever been a time or a season, can I preach tonight?
Yep.
If there's ever been a time or a season that the church has weight put on it, that the government's trying to put weight on us, the church is trying to put leverage on us,
yep,
is now. And but Jesus, through John, through the Word of God, Revelation chapter 2, he said, be willing to give up your life, because this is nothing. He said, this is a 10-day trial. He said, it's a 10-day trial. Some scholars say that those 10 days represented 10 years. I feel the preacher. And some of the scholars say that 10 meant that there was a beginning and there was an end. Well, I'll take that. Because if you read Revelation chapter 2 and verse 10, he said 10 years. You can't have 10 years unless you started on the first day. And when you start on the first day, that means whatever the enemy's trying to start with me, God took notice on the first day. And whatever I got to go through the rest of this trial, God's going to say, that's enough. That's enough.
That's good.
On the 10th day.
Mm-hmm.
What's the rest of that down through there say? What's the rest of that say down through there? 10th day, he said, 10th day. Oh, I know what he said. He said, and then all of you that make it through.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, come on, man.
Yeah.
Yeah, come on.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
He said, all you that make it through. He said, every one of you that persevered through this trial, he said, I'm going to give you a crown.
Yeah.
Don't seem too happy about that.
Uh-huh. Come on.
We all want a new car. Well, money buys that.
Uh-huh.
Hey, man, you get a good job, get good credit, or pay cash for something. You, I don't care what you do with your business. Mm-hmm. But I mean, you say, well, I get excited over a new house. Well, I ain't talking about a new house.
Uh-huh.
All these things are going to pass away. You hear me tonight? All these things are going to pass away. These houses, these cars, these buildings are all going to pass away. Hey, Matt, did you go to Ramelow Church of God? Is that where you went? Where did you go? I've seen you before. Where at?
Dallas.
In Dallas? Where'd you go before then?
Voice of Victory.
Oh, yeah, that's a good one. That's a good one. I feel like preaching.
Come on.
I'm about done, but I feel the preacher. He said, I'm going to give you a crown. You see, everybody, I told Heaven Bless you, everybody around there in the world and that paganism, they were all wearing these crowns on their head. They looked like wreaths. Amen. Mm-hmm. You know why God pointed you out tonight? Because God wants you to know you've not been forgotten.
Yep.
Did you know that? God wants me to tell you you've not been forgotten. God hasn't abandoned you. You might have had a crazy day or two. You might have had some roller coaster rides. The devil might have told you to end your life. But set your life is worth living.
Yep. Yep.
He said, in those times when old pagans would wear old things on their head, look like wreaths.
Mm-hmm.
Everybody would walk around and they wanted to kill anybody that didn't serve their God and their paganism. Mm-hmm. But the Christian believers, brother, you hear me? The Christian believers said, we don't serve a God like that.
Right.
That's why John wrote in Revelation chapter 2 that they're worried about a crown here.
Yep.
God said, if you'll me thankful here. I got a crown. I got a crown. I got a crown. That's something wrong right there. He said, I got a crown for you. You hear me? I got a crown for you. I don't know about you, but this life ain't nothing but a deposit on eternity.
Yep.
You hear me?
Uh-huh.
This life ain't nothing. You hear me? Ain't nothing. That's my South Gastonia dialect.
Yep.
This life ain't nothing.
Uh-huh.
But a deposit on your eternity.
Uh-huh.
And I'm going to tell you something. If you've ever been through a trial, and God got you through that trial. Do I got a witness out here that I don't have to beg to raise your hand that God brought you through a trial? Anybody, you can stand up if you want to. And is there anybody would stand up right now? You get the crown. You get the crown. You get the crown. You get one. You get one. You get one.
Oh, yeah.
I said, you get the crown. Now I'm done preaching. I've said all I'm supposed to say. I love you. My tie's wet. Thank God for you. My preacher can do the altar call. He's good at it. I just like preaching. Hallelujah. Leave on to Jesus, son. Hallelujah. I love y'all. Thank you for coming tonight. It's been a good time. Amen. Have you had a good time out of the tent tonight?
Hallelujah. Didn't you enjoy that tonight? Yeah. I want you to stand up all underneath the tent, outside the tent. How many of us, you know, that verse he kept talking about, Revelation chapter number 2, said, a crown that fadeth not away. Now, what they would do is they'd give them those crowns. It'd be just like the Olympics, like he said. And after a while, that crown would wilt. It would fade away. But also, in that, they wouldn't just give them a crown, they'd give them a white stone. To him that overcometh. Yeah, he knows where I'm going. To him that overcometh will I give that white stone. See, because there's going to be a time whenever the crown, whenever it wilts and fades away, but you're going to reach down and remember that God knew what you went through. God brought you out. God wrote your name on it. I say hallelujah. I bless his name. He's promised help. He's promised the Lord. And he will not forget you. Y'all boys, I'm going to make me want to preach. I wonder how many of us would come down around this altar and say, oh God, will you help me to remember? In Psalm 77, he said it like this. He said, when you feel like you've forgotten, just remember the years at thy right hand. Brother Robert, where you at? Where'd you go? Wherever he's at. Brother Robert, he often testifies about some things went on in your life. He often testifies about some things that went sideways. Didn't turn out like you thought they would. But I've also often heard you testify as well about the many years that God has shown himself faithful. There's some of you right now that have lost your health. You may have lost a child, or may have lost a spouse, but I'm glad to tell you, but there's been years at the right hand of God, years underneath the blessing of God, years underneath the help of God. And I want to say tonight that we ought to come tonight and say thank you, God, that when I look around and see the prosperity of the wicked, I can believe. I go to the house of God, and then I remember where you brought me from. I remember what you've done before. Hitherto, as the Lord kept us up to right now, He's been good. Come on, here we come. We're slipping out. We're coming to tell God thank you. Thank you for your faithfulness. Thank you for your goodness. Thank you for your mercy. Thank you, God, when I wasn't faithful, when I failed you, when I didn't act like I should, when I act a fool, God, you were faithful. Lord, I want to remember on purpose. I want to remember that tonight. Oh, the enemy has whispered in my ear. The enemy has told me all sorts of lies. There's been times they even thought about giving up and giving in. But God, then I remember. Oh, God. While these are coming, these are praying. While Satan is losing the battle in your life tonight, while Satan is throwing up his hands in defeat tonight, God has won another battle. God has won another victory. How many of us tonight, maybe you're not where you need to be with God. It's the last night of revival. You've been waiting on something to happen. What if God's been waiting on you? God's been waiting on you just to throw up the white flag. I surrender, I give up. You can have it, God. You can have all of me. With heads bowed and eyes closed while these are praying. You're here tonight and say, preacher, I know I'm saved, but I'm not where I need to be with God. With heads bowed and eyes closed, how many would throw your hand up? Just be honest. Thank you for being honest. I know I'm saved, but I'm not where I need to be. We see several hands. Somebody else. Here's my hand, God. Here's my hand. I'll be honest with you. We're going to pray in just a moment. You're here tonight to say, preacher, I do not know that I'm ready to meet God like I am. Last night, I had a teenage girl that was raised in church her whole life. Bowed an altar all by herself. Nobody knew why she was even down there praying. And she called out on the God of heaven. And she was saved last night in the altar. Spent her whole life in church. Maybe tonight God's calling you. Maybe tonight that altar's saying, come weary, come burdened, come just as you are, but come. Just a moment longer. Preacher, here's my hand. I'm not ready to meet God like I am. Would you pray for me? Is there somebody like that tonight? Here's my hand. Please pray for me. Father, in the name of Jesus, you know who we are. You know every situation underneath this tent. Thank you, God, for the preacher tonight. Thank you for the word. Thank you, God, for what it means to be able to come and to congregate and to meet with your children, to worship you in spirit and in truth. God, I love you tonight. Bless you. We love you. We bless you. In the mighty name of Jesus. And all God's people said, amen. 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 Praise the Lord. I don't know if you have a microphone or not. If you do, that's fine. If you don't, that's fine. Come up here real quick, if you will, and share something with us. Number one, be sure it's unmuted. I think I had to mute it a minute earlier. We appreciate Brother Kenny Marr, and how many of you were blessed by his ministry? The new key up at the top of number one there.
Praise the Lord.
There it is.
Well, I'm just thankful to be able to be at the last night of the meeting. Most of the time we're gone on Thursday because I pastor a church back home. But we're not having Thursday night services this month, so I told Brother Chris I was going to stay. I was going to stay anyway, even if we had church. And but I'm telling you, boy, I got fed tonight. Didn't you get fed tonight? Amen. I'm thankful that there's still some old-time meetings like this across the country. We're living in a day when there's a famine for the preaching of the Word of God. But I'm grateful tonight that they still some old stump knockers just believe it and open up that old book, rear back, let the Holy Ghost get a hold of their thoughts, and just giving what God's saying. Amen. I'm glad I'm going to get a crown. Hallelujah. I'm glad this trial is going to last too long. I'm glad God sees the other end of it. I give Him glory for it. Praise God. I tell you, 2020, I fought hell by the acre. But I'm glad Jesus has walked with me every step of the way. I'm glad I don't have to go through a battle alone. I don't have to face a fire alone.
Yep.
I don't have to go through tribulation by myself.
Hallelujah.
I'm glad there's still a God that says that I'm working all things out for His glory and for my good. And I give nothing for
Him tonight.
And I can be the God's people and worship the Lord. Amen. It sounds like y'all going in the sanctuary next Sunday. Amen. If you're thankful, you're headed back to the sanctuary. Just one more time, put your hands together. Give God some glory in the pit tonight. Hallelujah. Tuesday. Amen. You pray for us. We got to pull this thing down tonight. So if three or four of y'all want to hang out and work out, we'll use you tonight. Amen.
Amen. And Brother Kenny, I hate to ask you to do this, but I want you to come back real quick.
Okay.
Brother Kenny does this better than anybody I know. We're going to take up an offering. Amen. You've been faithful to give, and we thank God for you. I want you just to share on the pastor side. You've done this as an evangelist. I want you to share on the pastor side what all this is about and how that people can be involved. And you can share what we do when we have him in. He helps us. He blesses us. But we also are able to help him along. He told me they're getting ready to go out west, and you tell them how much those tanks of gas are. And if you want to be involved in that to help them to get the gospel out west, you can do that. So, fellas, get those buckets ready. We'll be hanging out by the back on the way out. Go ahead.
Well, as the preacher said tonight, it takes money to do this. I paid $11,000 for this tent about 9 years ago. It's been through a lot of storms. We're fixing to buy another one. It's actually going up to about $15,000. That's just the expenses of a meeting. But the pastor bears the burden of that, and he always asks his people to try to be a part of that. Sometimes they can get the money ahead of time, but you hadn't had church. But he stepped out in faith and did it anyway. So tonight what you ought to do is just reach down real deep, say, I want to give a little offering tonight to help defer the expenses. The money you're giving in the bucket goes to the pastor, and at his discretion, he gives it out where it needs to go. And I thank God for people. Now, let me ask you a question. Did you get a blessing tonight? Amen? Was it worth you digging into your stimulus money and pulling 20 or 40 or 50 or 100 out, dropping it in the Kentucky Fried Chicken bucket? Amen? As he already stated, let me mention this. I'll be leaving in about 3 weeks. I'll be headed out west to do some mission work. We're going to an Indian reservation. We're going to try to do a vacation Bible school in North Dakota and a nightly evangelistic rally underneath this tent. Then I'll be in Montana doing the same thing, a vacation Bible school, a nightly evangelistic rally. Then we'll be in Wyoming doing a meeting with a pastor there. And then we'll head back home. And we've got a youth camp at home we'll be having at the end of July. But we're going to be heading out west. It takes about anywhere from $7,500 to $10,000 to take care of the expenses of that. We've actually raised $1,500 of that. So if you'd like to be a part of that, you can see me after the service. I'll be around here. And you can write a check. It's tax deductible. You can give. You can go on credit card. If you've got a credit card, I can put as much as $1,000 on it. It won't hurt my feelings. Amen. I'll also say this. Maranatha has a way you can give by your credit card, too. If you want to give through Tithely, you can go see the man of God. He'll direct traffic. Here's the thing. Guys, don't park on somebody else's dime. Be a part of the work of God. Hey, just help somebody take it a little bit further. Give tonight. Where's those Kentucky Fried Chicken buckets? Where are they at? You see these two men? Y'all go by there and drop some money in those buckets. And if you'd like to help us, we'd appreciate it. Amen. Have you enjoyed these guys up here? Have a piece of the service, son. Hallelujah. I think I would preach myself to death if I had those kind of guys. Amen, Brother Chris.
All right. Praise the Lord. If you can't help us tonight, we're going to be tearing all this down. And so hang around with us. Help us out. Lord willing, we will be talking to our Maranatha Church family. We will be here at 11 a.m. meeting in the sanctuary.
Yes, in the sanctuary.
Amen. We're asking you to please do not come in before 10:45. We're going to have everything in order in there. And I'm looking. How many of you looking back to go? Looking forward to going back into the sanctuary? Amen. All right. God bless you. We love you.